suggesting, unless it's a different information, we would lag behind other parts of the world. And the challenge for integration remains as much a challenge at the regional level, sub-regional level, as it is at the AU level. If you remember the Abuja Treaty of 1993, spoke of an African community, an African economic community by the year 2026. We are 5 or 6 years away from that, or nowhere near the very benchmarks that were set by that treaty. And likewise, the SADC treaty, the Vintage treaty, in 1992, we are still very far from it. What are the main constraints to regional integration? The first is vertical integration in the North Hemisphere. And this is both historical but also current. Our economies in SADC, individually and collectively, are largely an extension of those of the North Hemisphere. In my country, for example, we are using the US dollar. Notwithstanding our reported anti-imperialist stance, we continue, all our countries, in the same mode that Sister John Rhodes pointed out in 1848 as part of the colonial mission, that we as colonials, we need colonies to get raw materials with which to feed our factories and thereby create employment for our people. And without employment, we can push it. I would ask, what's the difference today? We continue to export jobs in the form of raw materials out the north. Our gold, our gas. Deep integration as a region, as a continent, as Africa, we will not know why. The second, of course, major constraint to regional integration is the legacy of uneven and unequal development between and within our various countries. And you can see, for example, the extent to which that affects even the human resource development sector. For example, given the economic woes in our country, Zimbabwe, right now 75% of all professional and skilled Zimbabweans are outside the country. 75%. And most of them in South Africa, and even in the metropolitan regions, in the Western European UK. It is no secret, for example, that many of the health sector in Africa is almost dependent on the government skills. But then there's created an even greater legacy of uneven development. Just to give another statistic. Zimbabwe had one of the best medical schools in the world. And at independence, I think I don't know where the bio came from, but it read out, not just the ones that I gave. But I worked in South Africa for 10 years, from 1980, came with the liberation movement. And one of the things that we worked very hard at was education and human development. And we had an educational revolution with River Rose. And we, by 1981 already, we were no longer importing skills for which we self-sufficient by the end of the 80s. In same medical field. So, sadly, the last year of the last year of medical school eventually collapsed on the back of very adverse policies, of course, and also the lack of attention to the kind of policies that we followed in the 1980s. And so you have a lot of nutrition, of skills, of basic specialists that they are many outside the country. And with the strike side, medical doctors, nurses, the hospital formation closed. And with the hospital closed, the medical school too has to close, because the medical school, the hospital are essential for the training. So we have, in fact, this year, the medical students eventually learned something. And those who graduated last year, 95% of their graduation. That alone can tell you what the situation in terms of health is in our country. The third and probably constraint to this legislation is, of course, the problem of nation state. Our nation states are in a problem by definition. And as long as we are focused on our national problems, we are not to aim for regional or constitutional issues. So we pay lip service to African nation. And therefore, I think on the occasion of honoring this great African, what it is, Sefularo, I think we should restate the challenges that face us. We need leadership in the region, on the continent. We miss very much the old Pan-Africans, the Tunisians, the Afro Nigerians. We need a fresh injection of new visions, people with a broader vision of development. We need an extra dose of Pan-Africans. Above all, we need to organize and pay more attention to the additional issues. As we say in the Pan-African movement, don't agonize, organize. And thank you.
Thank you very much, Ivo Mendoza, for sharing with us what the state of the healthcare is in our neighboring country, Zimbabwe, and how then we yearn for the type of leadership that will see to the success of regional integration for health in this country. Allow me to introduce Comrade Sisa Njikelana, who will introduce our keynote speaker for today. I just decided to take just very few snippets about Comrade Sisa Njikelana. He studied in social sciences at the Ruskin College, Oxford, in the UK, where he did leadership in communications, master's program in local economic development, and he has been a member of parliament since 2004 to 2018. And was the chairperson of the Portfolio Committee on Energy from May 2009 to May 2014. Come, Sister Jigelana, please introduce our keynote speaker for this afternoon.
And Professor Mandela has been
very, very forthcoming, frank enough, thanks to you, Prof, that much as you get this on the table, the ease of adaptation. Whether it's systems, whether it's the healthcare itself, whether it's academic healthcare professionals, we should have